form of my thesis, but I do have a copy of it.
So it says the atom spectral sequence is, so the atom spectral sequence for these guys is not too bad if it's free over BP. I mean, I don't know the differentials or anything. Well, we'll talk.
No, there are a lot of differentials.
So some of the generators are in part degree.
I'm going to have to go real quick, just for the first time.
Sure.
Oh, that was more than the first time. Well, or about the, yeah, the 90%.
Oh, okay. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, so
may all your orientations be nice.
Okay, you're being recorded now.
Be careful what you say.
Okay. Hello
there. I didn't realize you were sitting in the back.
So we stop in 1 hour and then we go for, is that good? For
well, we don't have drinks. To. You know, wait for a full hour.
Yeah, I would advocate that.
Well, we want to hear everything.
Yes.
You can. You have to tell us. Yeah. Sorry. Sorry.
No.
Okay, so.
I'll catch a later train.
So where did I forgot where I left off.
So yeah, can you sum up what was done and what is being going to be done?
Well, I don't know what's going to be done.
Yeah.
And but you do know what was done.
I think I remember what was done. So I defined an infinity topoi. And also a ring.
Yeah.
Infinity topos.
What was that?
Yeah. And I showed, and you know, in this we get a notion of cohomology. F. If F. Is any OX module. And these cohomologies, they generalize any type of state of homotopy theory. So I did the example of like how they generalize to reconstruct in the very easy case where X is just stasis and O is the constant sheaf on a ring spectrum, how they just give you
that general gave the
twisted R homology and cohomology.
So those were examples. Right. Did you give a second example of X and O later, or no?
Yes. So, yeah, the first example
was spaces and given an E
spaces
theory.
Spaces with the constant sheaf associated to the infinity ring spectrum, and then this is like the resulting
and
homology and cohomology are the twisted R cohomology. But with
so
twist,
you,
not
you,
necessarily.
You get an OX module for every twist.
No, the OX module is the twist.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. And, well, then we had another example where X would say a tall sheaves over, well, let's say over the moduli stack of oriented derived elliptic curves, and O is defined by O of fact are. The infinity ring spectrum R.
It's the tautological.
Yes, it's tautological variance.
And how much of this was, I could have, how much of it was related to the fact that M was the moduli?
Nothing, it's pulled back from.
So that is, I could replace M for any.
Any object of she's a tall or the sphere.
So it's the over category of.
Yeah.
That's a tall sheaves over the sphere.
Well,
what do you mean by S?
Let's say, I mean, I don't know if writing spec S will help, probably not, but this is, I'm viewing this as a subcategory of functors from commutative S algebras to spaces on those ones that satisfy a tall descent. So M is an. But I wanted to take the particular example of M, derived moduli stack, which curves. And well, we'll have a third type of example is if you have. And you have the geometric morphism of infinity topoi, say, from y to x. Here, this is written in the left adjoint direction. I can pull back the sheaf to y.
Sorry, S is sphere spectrum?
Yeah, S is the sphere spectrum in this case. Just, yes. Just because S is what makes this the same as the infinity ring spectrum. So I need the infinity in order to really do algebraic geometry and, consider it S because it's the initial, the infinity. Okay, but here's a way of creating ringed infinity topoids to have a ring on something and give a map of infinity topoid from that to that. So to be a map of infinity topoid in the left adjoint direction, it has to be a left exact. Left edge. So left adjoints are automatically right exact because they preserve all co-limits. But
are you here?
You also want it to preserve finite limits.
Is there a way to make the cotangent complex into an example?
Of what?
Like a stack.
The cotangent complex of what?
Like if X is a stack, then to every category, every other stack over it, you assign the cotangent complex or something like that.
Yeah.
Would that work?
Well, I mean, the cotangent complex considered as a quasi-coherent sheaf.
Yeah.
The thing, yeah. So that, so the cotangent complexes give you examples of
those
quasi-coherent O X modules. So that's something that I can take the cohomology of.
What? Yeah. What do you get?
Well, the cohomology of the cotangent complex will be the dual, so it'll be the tangent complex, or the homotopy groups of the tangent complex, which exactly related to deformations. And the homology of the cotangent complex will be its homology.
Okay.
So in your third example, what's F?
Any morphism of infinity topoi. Okay. I'm just spelling out what it means to give morphism of infinity topoi in the left adjoint direction. It has to be left exact in addition to being left adjoint. Then you can pull back a sheaf of rings on X to Y. So this is in fact how you want to now construct. So let's take for example, the homotopy theory of Arbenstacks that I was talking about. This is topological stacks. The weak equivalence is inverted. It's what Stefan Schwede would call global unstable homotopy theory. And this thing, because it's equivalent to, we know what it looks like as an infinity topoi. It's pre-sheaves on this category I was describing, and we know that this is the classifying, well, technically, this sub-topos, pre-sheaves on the abelian ones, is the classifying infinity topos for oriented abelian group objects. So
there's a question.
Yeah.
Did you ever define what oriented abelian
group? No, I was going to right now though. So so
can I make one comment too? Because Jeffrey was telling us last week what Hammack localization was.
Uh-huh.
So this is just, this localization you're using is the same concept. You're just, your weak equivalences
right.
You define, and you're just doing the Hammack localization.
Right, that's a way of constructing this infinity category is by the Hammack localization of that. So let me just define what an oriented.
Thanks for asking.
Hmm? Oriented the abelian.
Thanks for asking that.
Liz, yeah. Group object in X.
What does the word have to end in definition?
Oriented.
Oh, oriented abelian
right.
Group object. Okay.
Is, well, first of all, it's an abelian group object. Now, this is a rather subtle point, what this means. So, normally, it's a sheaf, let's say it's a sheaf of, well, I'll use the spectra, connective HZ module spectra. Do those words make sense to people? I'm taking advantage of the fact that there's the infinity category of chain complexes, which I'll write as the nerve of chain complexes. Modulo weak equivalences is can be identified with the infinity category of HZ modules. And of course you can embed, you know, you can think of this as like a derived Bionian group. Okay, and I'm just looking at the ones that are, you know, don't have any non-negative homotopy groups. Another way that you can
positively graded chain complex.
Right. Another way of doing it is you can take simplicial abelian groups. And invert the weak equivalences. That's another way of constructing it. This is probably the most obvious. I mean, this is why it's being referred to as an abelian group object. It's a derived version of an abelian group. It's a simplicial abelian group, but you know, I don't want to consider them up to isomorphism. I want to consider them up to homotopy equivalence. Is that clear? I mean, there's another thing. You could ask why you. There's another good candidate, which would be connected to the spectrum, which is the same thing as group like E infinity spaces, which might be what you would expect to play the role of a derived abelian group. There's a functor this way, which is not an equivalent. It's just that, I don't know, you can, in the world of infinity categories, there's an entire hierarchy of abeliannesses between this category and this category, coming from the fact that I can truncate the sphere at any level, and the zero truncation sphere is HZ. So
that map is just inclusion?
I mean
change of rings?
No, it's just the forgetful functor.
I mean there's a map of rings from S to HZ.
Right.
And so this is just change the base, right?
Well, it's not base change would be tensor map. This is just restriction.
Restrictions, yes.
And the point is that you could any modules over any of these things could be called abelian group objects. For n anywhere from 0 to infinity inclusive. Here at infinity, I don't truncate the sphere at all. They both, it's just that.
Can you explain that? Why, for example, how you get HZ that way?
By truncating the sphere at 0, just because pi 0.
And there's nothing else.
Great.
So, so there's sort of a. For each truncation level of the sphere, there's something that you might call an infinity category of abelian group objects. And the point is I'm taking the strictest one possible from this point of view, which is actually, you know, happens to be equivalent to the nerve of simplicial abelian groups, but is not the same as group-like E-infinity spaces, or which are infinite loop spaces.
Is that top map an inclusion?
It's not an inclusion.
It's a restriction.
Okay.
It's a restriction.
You're restricting your
module. It's not fully faithful. It's neither fully faithful nor essentially surjective. They're very different categories, and that's But
are modules over HC always products of Eilenberg-MacLane spaces?
Yes.
So they don't have any K invariants,
right.
Whereas the other
right.
ones have
exactly.
K invariants.
These are the same as spectra with all trivial K invariants. Well, connected spectra with all trivial K invariants. So it's a very, I mean, if you allow your K invariants to be non-trivial, you can build up an arbitrary spectrum, but this is saying that all the K invariants are trivial. And there's a, I mean, from the point of view of one category theory, if I took abelian group objects into one category, you wouldn't be able to see the difference between any of these. But in an infinity category, you can, even though they all look commutative. Okay, so it's rather hard to explain at first why you take this as your notion of abelian group, but you'll see why eventually. So it's a sheaf of connected HZ module spectra on X, and so I can view that as, in fact, as an object whose you know, an ellipse of the functor represents. Here it's factoring through connective HZ modules via the functor loops infinity. So it's an object and a lift of its functor of points to here. That's what makes an abelian group object or a sheaf of abelian groups in an infinity topos. And, well, and it's oriented if, well, I can take the classifying, I can take, consider the following abelian group object. I can take the classifying space of the circle. So T here is the circle. And I can take the coproduct of, I can take the BT index coproduct of the terminal object in my topos. And I say that it comes with a map like that. Like that, this is pre-oriented. This is, in other words, you can think of this as I'm taking BT many tensor power. This object exists in any infinity category with all co-limits and a terminal object, because you just take, let's write it like this. The co-limit over the infinity groupoid BT, or if you want CP infinity, of the terminal object,
one. So this is like the total space of a bundle over CP infinity or something like that?
No, it's what? Just it's just I have a terminal object of my infinity topos, and I'm taking CP infinity in many copies of it.
So that would give you a bundle over CP infinity.
it's not living over CP infinity because I don't know what the terminal object of my infinity topos lives over.
Uh-huh. I see.
So you're indexing the terminal object by CP infinity itself. So you're taking a copy of the terminal object indexed by the cells of CP infinity.
Exactly.
And you're not really gluing them together. So you took the co-limits. I mean, there's no, the attaching maps to CP infinity play no role.
Well, they...
They do.
They do. Let me give you an example. If I took the co-limit over S2 of the terminal object, this could be written as the pushout. Well, let me start with S1. I have, this is S0 copies of one, and now I map it, it's the pushout of this, which I map to 1, this I map to 1.
I see.
This pushout is S1 copies.
Oh, that's what you mean.
Okay. And if I do that...
This is like Hochschild.
It's
like...
It's similar if this were a tensor product, but it's the co-product.
Is it like a homotopy push-out?
Yes, it's automatically a homotopy
push-out. So you are really enlarging the terminal object.
Right.
You're sort of fattening. It's like replacing a point with a disk.
Right.
And your inclusions, so it's the way one would build up CP infinity in the homotopy pushout language.
Right, exactly.
You're replacing the points by the disks.
Exactly. I
think I understand it.
I'm using the abstract way that CP infinity is built up to, out of points, out of the point in spaces, which build it up out of the point in an arbitrary infinity topos. And because this has an abelian group structure, this is an abelian group object.
Yep.
Okay, and now, so I'm going to call this object, this colimit, I'm just going to call it BT. Tensor.
Okay.
Terminal object of my topos.
So if we were in the category of topological spaces, and the point is that really is hot CP infinity.
Right. It really is CP infinity. But if we're
this generalizes CP infinity to a general category with a terminal object.
Right. Exactly.
Okay.
So to give a map of abelian group objects from this to that is by a junction to give a map of abelian group objects and spaces. So, okay, this mapping space, let me write it properly. Map of abelian group objects from here to here is by a junction. So this is abelian group objects in X. It's by a junction map of abelian group objects in spaces, which is just this category, from BT to the space of global points of A. This is the, let me write it as the space of maps in X from 1 to A.
By a junction.
Right. And this has a canonical abelian group structure because I enforced that in my definition what an abelian group object is. Except now, this, as an abelian group object, is free is an HZ module, this is the second suspension of HZ. So in other words, it's the free abelian group object on the two sphere. Calculate that. This is just saying that CP infinity is the second delooping of Z. Do you want me to explain any of these identifications? I mean, maybe they're weird when you see them for the first time, but if you're familiar with homotopy theory, you get used to that.
Well, they are both formal. Their cohomologies are the same.
Right. I mean,
cohomology of ZS2 and BT are the same. They're both polynomial ring in one generator.
Right. I mean, another way.
And that would be.
I was saying that is that. If I just write Z for the free abelian group object from, well, in this case, pointed spaces to abelian group objects in S, well, this preserves colimits because it's a free functor. Okay, and it sends S0 to Z, so it has to send S2, if I think of this as, say, connective HZ algebras, has to send S2, which is the double suspension of S0, to the double suspension, well, I'll send it to HZ, which, well, which, if you're then viewing them as actually, simplicial abelian groups. Like that, loops infinity of this. It's just knowing that as an H, that, this is the second space in the spectrum for HZ tells you that as an abelian group object, it's the free abelian group object on S2. It's just a matter of tracing through a bunch of adjunctions. But then because this is free, this is just a map from from S2 into the mapping space from 1 into A. So in other words, homotopy classes of maps of abelian group objects in X from BT tensor 1 into A is exactly pi 2, the mapping space in X from 1 to A. Okay, so this is the sense in which something, and this is of course some HZ module. So it's starting to look like, I mean, a complex orientation is, amounts to a certain element in the R theory of CP infinity, which is really sort of what's going on here, hence the name. But so it's easy to classify a preorientation that's just giving an element of pi 2. And, well, you can check then that the preorientation, so this will be a definition. This preorientation, this map of abelian group objects, is an orientation if, well, what I can do is I can take the identity section of my abelian group object and take the pullback here, which is the loop space of A, and if I do that to BT tensor A, I mean BT tensor 1, and I look at the identities, and I pull it back, you can check that you get T tensor 1. Mm-hmm. And you get an induced map from here to here by naturality. And the condition on it being an orientation is that T tensor 1 is equivalent to loops A. Or another way of saying is that BT tensor 1 is equivalent to B loops A, which I'm going to call the formal part of A. But in practice, A is going to be something like a elliptic curve or a multiplicative group. And if I perform this, I really am going to get the formal completion of that curve at the identity.
So your definition of B omega A is to take the colimit over omega A 1? I mean, I'm just trying to. You define B for
So
you define B for T. I mean, for right. Over there.
So
I just want to know what B of omega A is. I just want to know if it's something.
It's what you think.
I have an idea of what it is, but how does it fit? Is it a colimit of something? Oh, it's the cobar, or the bar.
Yeah. Something.
Okay. But I'm just trying to reconcile it with the definition you get over there for
it's the bar construction.
Right. So that is the bar construction for one, essentially.
Right.
Okay.
So.
This is very different from group completion. That's like omega B of A somehow, but this is B of omega.
Right. This is. So what does B omega do? Let me give an example.
Okay.
So let's just to get a feeling for what it does. What if we take the stack I claimed that this infinity topos of pre-sheaves on abelian orbits is the classifying topos. Classifies oriented abelian group objects. So that means it has to have, in particular, an abelian group object in it, which is the orbit stack BT. This is the Artin stack, which is just T acting on the point. Not to be confused with the classifying space of T. Well, what happens when I take, so the, loop space here, BT, well, you can, it's an easy calculation to check that this is actually the classifying space. Sorry, this is actually T. That's an easy calculation. So, but then, so B omega of BT is the classifying space of T. As opposed, it's the, that admits a map into the stack BT, because this has a canonical T-bundle over it. But this is a space and this is a stack. So you can view this as like the formal neighborhood of the identity inside of this stack. If in the case where A is an oriented elliptic curve, you can check that A hat is equivalent, well, the underlying scheme of A hat, let me parenthesize. How do I parenthesize this? So first I take the completion, then I look at the underlying scheme. That's the same as the underlying scheme completed along the zero section. So this sort of surprised me when I figured it out, because it's saying that this completion process, which is just a formal thing that you're doing in your infinity topos, is reconstructing some very interesting maps for you. So if I apply it to this, to any stack of the form BG, this completion is just the space BG. And when I apply it to an oriented elliptic curve or an oriented multiplicative group, etc., the completion is really the completion of the underlying scheme. So it's an interesting functor. So being oriented is very, very strong, because as Mahmoud, you were asking before, so to have an oriented elliptic curve over an HZ algebra, what do you need to have? Well, you're going to need that the underlying elliptic curve has, well, let's put it like this, has as its formal completion you can check. So I'm not saying how to check this now, but just as its completion, the formal spectrum. To the CP infinity, which is, well, which is impossible because if this is an elliptic curve, its formal group law is not going to agree with the formal group law of any HZ algebra, complex oriented HZ algebra, unless R is rational. Because it's only over the rationals that formal groups of higher than zero and formal groups of height zero can agree with each other. So this is one of the reasons why it's actually hard to find examples of oriented derived elliptic curves. But anyway, maybe that's a little bit abstract, but
over the rational, they are all additive, right?
Right. Over the rationals, they're all additive because you have the logarithm map.
Yeah.
But but unless you have all denominators, you can't generally do that. Okay. So. Anyway, so the way that you define now elliptic cohomology of, say, some topological hardened stack, call it X, is, well,
so this and this is not, there's no group involved here yet, or is it? X is secretly can be like X mod G or something.
Yeah, for.
So this is in the or on the orb category.
For
right?
example, M with G acting on
yeah.
this. Okay, but whatever. I mean, it can be anything. So you take your ring object, you have this functor f upper star that goes from pre-sheaves on abelian orbits, and you have, in fact, even a morphism of topoi like this, which just restricts along the inclusion here into here. I'll call this I upper star. And here you have your infinity topos of sheaves over the moduli stack, like this, which is, this map is classifying the universal oriented derived elliptic curve. So this topos has a ring object in it, so I can pull it back to get a ring object on this category. Here, and then let me just write G for the composite. And then, well, the elliptic cohomology of something in here. X is defined to be, you know, just the value of this on X. This is some infinity ring spectrum. It's in fact, by functoriality, a module over the elliptic cohomology of a point, which is this on the point, which by definition is O evaluated on its terminal object, which is M, which is TMF. The periodic TMF. So it's a module over this. And, well, there's a lot more functoriality here than I've written down. In fact, you can define the elliptic cohomology of a map, even. And this is going to be useful because this is defined as, well, the global sections of, you shouldn't call this F, we call this phi. So, this is defined as the global sections of the push forward of O X, where phi is a functor from this lower shriek, is the left adjoint push forward functor from, well, G upper star O Y modules to G upper star O X modules. And the reason why this is important is that if Y is a point, then this map is the elliptic, it's the elliptic homology of X. Because remember, the cohomology is obtained by taking global sections or the right adjoint push forward to a point. But if I take the left adjoint push forward to a point, I'm taking its homology. And, well, over the point, I guess I don't even have to write.
So G upper star of O of X is in mod G upper star of O of X. It's a G upper star of O X module, right?
Yeah.
So the upper, the lower shriek is going to, but the domain of G upper G lower shriek is G upper star of O Y module.
Yes, sorry, that was.
So you got that backwards.
Yeah. So the way that you take the elliptic homology of something is by pushing it forward along the resulting map between module categories and then taking its global sections. So what this actually...
This is like there's a Tom spectrum discussion hidden here.
Yeah, well, there's hidden here a few things. First of all, this makes this into something that's bivariant, so it's covariantly functorial in this variable and contravariantly functorial in this variable. The homology is given by looking at the map x to a point, and the cohomology is given by looking at the identity map, because if I just take the identity map here, I'm not changing it. I'm just taking global sections.
Those global sections way back, they're somehow related to the right adjoint, perhaps? Remember?
Right. So, well,
remember there was a right adjoint which was essentially section. So I'm just wondering if this related to the right adjoint you were talking about somewhat earlier.
Right. So all of these module categories have forgetful functors
right
down to the spectra. So I'm just sort of using
okay
that here.
All right.
And these forgetful functors commute with various right adjoints because
right,
they're
okay
forgetful functors. So you can rewrite them as first pushing forward, but you also don't have to.
Okay.
So so what does that actually tell you? Well, the way that this works is that this functor from pre-sheaves on abelian orbits into X. This is going to send. So an abelian orbit is just something that looks like a torus across a bunch of finite. That any abelian compact Lie group, if you just get rid of the B's, looks like, you know, this infinite rank part, well, cyclic part crosses, you know, cyclic infinite order cyclic part crosses finite order cyclic part. And so this is an object there, and that gets sent to under this. Well, my abelian group object in X is equipped with the same functoriality. So it goes to n copies of A cross the torsion points inside the elliptic curve, where A, the K torsion is the fiber of the map which multiplies by K. And so using this, you know, dictionary, you see that the, say, elliptic homology of this stack is exactly the global sections of your universal oriented elliptic curve. And this is, well, you can use now Grothendieck serduality show that actually this thing, since an elliptic curve is proper, it's maybe I should write of the structure sheaf of A. That's probably a better way of writing it. Gamma OA is equivalent to TMF plus a shift of TMF by some degree. I think where D is congruent to plus or minus 3 mod 24, or maybe 24 squared. So this is coming from the fact that, well, the underlying elliptic curve, I mean, its cohomology ring, you know, locally looks like, you know, H0 plus H1. Just by the fact that the elliptic curve is proper, so that, you know, the global sections of the pushboard of its structure sheaf is some final module over H0 of M, and in particular, because it's a genus 1 curve, you know that it looks locally like that. Now, when you translate that into TMF, this one becomes something a little bit more complicated.
These are still non-compactified moduli spaces?
Yes.
And you can apply growth in the cert duality?
Yes, because you're not applying it to M, you're applying it to A.
Oh, I see.
The map from A to M is proper. And what this implies is that well, if you do a more delicate analysis of it, in other words, if I look at A is my elliptic curve that maps down to M. I guess I'm using this notation now. This map has the feature that, let me call this map P, because it's the projection to the terminal object of the topo. So P lower star O of A splits off as this map has a section, which is the identity section, which gives you a splitting of this as O plus a certain invertible sheaf where I is an invertible OM module. This is what you can conclude by using Grothendieck serenduality. And this has a special, this has a very interesting consequence. Which is that
is I some suspension of O of M?
Yeah. So locally, I is a suspension of
right.
O of M. It's globally twisted
right.
by
okay.
this
right.
omega, but
okay.
locally it's a suspension by
some right, degree. Yeah.
And it has an interesting consequence. It means that so, in elliptic cohomology, and this is a feature that it's completely unique to elliptic cohomology, but probably has some sort of theoretical explanation once we understand more about higher height cohomology theories. But what you can do is you can look at the endofunctor of smashing with the stack BT. Okay, because this is a pointed object. There's a canonical map from the point to BT because it's an abelian group object. So I can smash a stack with it. So this goes from the topos of pointed global homotopy types to itself. This is not an invertible operation. Invertible, typically, but is invertible in elliptic cohomology. It ends up just being tensoring with this I that we have. Because, I mean, smashing with this is like taking the Cartesian product but then getting rid of the base point. And you should think of M here. OM is the base point. So what happens is that you just are tensoring with I. So this is some sort of, this suggests that elliptic cohomology has Tom isomorphisms for many more types of objects.
You mean there are more orientable objects than the ones you defined? Is that what that means?
Yeah, I mean, it essentially means that you know, elliptic cohomology sees this object as a sphere, as a, you know, the elliptic cohomology of this as a pointed object ends up being in pick of OM. So,
for example, that you just observe, at least locally, that's just a suspension. Is that the dimension of the suspension somehow related to the dimension of the Tom class, or, I mean?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, so.
I mean, that's what you would think.
So we can't quite figure out what the exact dimension is yet, but I mean, but that's a local statement. Anyway, the point is that
even when you do a Tom isomorphism, it's a local. The condition
right.
is local. You put a point in, and you insist you hit a
right.
generator, which is exactly what you're writing out.
Right. Exactly. So the Tom isos are still going to work. The point is that it's mysterious why this thing should be an invertible object in elliptic cohomology, because I don't know any other theory in which it's tensor invertible.
I mean, I don't know, but Tillman-Bauer and others have a way of trying to interpret E3. I mean, you're going one step higher.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of, I forget how it goes, it's sort of like N-brains or something like
yeah.
that. And so there's some geometry underlying it. It's
mm-hmm.
like the next stage after elliptic curves. And do you think this machinery could sort of grab hold of that?
Well, you can certainly put in, I mean, so what we sort of expect happens is that as you go up, I mean, smashing with the circle was already invertible
right.
in spectra, right? But we should sort of expect that, I mean, this is a, if your theory is at chromatic height n, I expect all the objects, the de-loopings of t up to degree n minus 1 to be
invertible.
Like invertible objects, but I have no idea
of filtration.
Yeah,
everything up to there is it's invertible. But when you get to the end, you've really got some. You get an iso.
Right.
I mean, you get some action. Yeah. So it's.
So, yeah. So, I'll just stop here because I don't want to. It'll take too long to explain all these calculations, but it's an interesting. An unexplored feature of elliptic cohomology that this becomes a tensor invertible object in the theory, and I'm still trying to figure out what that actually means. I mean, ideally from like a physics-y interpretation, but let me just stop there.
Questions?
So, I mean, if I naively think of elliptic cohomologies like E2,
not super naive.
Why does this guy in that line, in a naive elliptic cohomology defined maybe in terms of a Witten genus, you know, you're tensoring over the Witten genus to get modular forms and all that kind of nonsense.
Right.
What is this? Does that fit into? Can I understand this in terms of the Witten genus? I guess is part of the question.
If he's extended, everything is equivariant. That's one.
Yeah. So the classifying space is not invertible, but the stack.
But the stack. Okay.
The stack is invertible.
Oh, that's where I got confused. All right.
But I mean, there. You can. You could ask about what is the, you know, Witten genus of this stack, I imagine.
I guess you could define it.
Yeah, and it would be interesting.
And it's a complicated thing involving operations, exterior power operations, and symmetric power operations, but I could formally write that down.
Right, or you could use the map from M string to
TMI. You could do that too. So there is a Witten genus in this language.
Right, there is a Witten genus in this language. Well, so, I mean, you know that any string manifold, because of this E-infinity map, I mean, you know that string manifolds will have Tom isomorphisms. And this has to be related to this somehow, because string is, you know, a BT bundle over B spin. So
do these numbers somehow, I mean, these undefined Ds that you haven't figured out, they're somehow related to some of the terms that appear in the Eisenstein series or something?
No, they're just related to what happens in sincere duality. The fact that you have, so the dualizing complex in this case is the line bundle omega. Mm-hmm. And that sits in homotopy degree 2. And then this degree shift coming from serre duality adds another degree to make it 3. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to try to guess the sign, but we only know that up to the periodicity of TMF itself, because it's 24 squared periodic, so we don't. Can't really say what it is.
Oh, I
but
see.
It's plus or minus 3.
But everything's defined just because you have no control over what copy of where you are out in the TMF spectrum.
Right.
You just have no control over that at all.
Right, exactly.
So that's where the periodicity should
be. Right. But this D is definitely 3 up to a sign. I have to think if it's the homological 3 or the cohomological.
Right. Oh, okay. Pick the right decide whether the star is up or down.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
One question.
Yeah.
If you replace this moduli stack of elliptic curves with, let's say, multiplicative groups, mm-hmm. do you get anything beyond what's already known about equivariant K-theory, et cetera?
That's a very good question. What you get that's not so clear is how what the new information about equivariant K theory that you get from this picture is the following. So the multiplicative group is improper, right? But any of its K torsion points is a proper scheme. So what you can deduce from that is that there are transfers in equivariant K theory along, you know, stacks whose fibers are classifying spaces of, you know, finite abelian groups.
Sorry.
Which you might be able to understand geometrically through some sort of, you know, integration map on the level of vector bundles or representations. But here you just see homotopy theoretically that you're going to get some transfers, more transfers than you normally would. So for example, if I just do stable global homotopy theory and don't smash with K, I wouldn't have transfers for any of these maps. But in K theory, I get them for these, and then in elliptic homology, I get them for even a wider class of types of vibrations. And the other thing is that people haven't studied equivariant K-homology very much, but it tells you how to think about equivariant K-homology.
Right.
And which is subtle, because equivariant K-homology of something of, say, BG is the same as the K-homology of its classifying space. But that's no longer true if you take, say, the relative thing over some other BH. Then this is only over a point. As soon as you look at this relative, this twisted thing, you actually get, you know, I can think of this as some version of the twisted cohomology of BH, twisted homologically by this map from BG. And that's not going to agree with the K theory of, you know, BG over BH. So it says something, it says that twisted equivariant K homology is different than you would expect by just knowing about ordinary K homology.
I see.
Is there a spectral sequence maybe by filtering BG over BH, filtering BH by like contractible pieces? So E22.
That's the thing, it's not the space.
Well, I'm looking at the right side.
Oh, yeah, on the right side, sure. There's
right, so you get a spectral sequence that would be converging to something.
Right, I mean, you just...
Yeah.
It'll...
Yeah, I was definitely thinking of the right side, not the left, I really. Yeah.
That's the point, is that this has a very different type of cell structure than that. So, any further questions?
Okay. Any further questions?
Let's eat.
Okay. Let's thank David again.
You should have stopped me like 20 minutes ago.